Dead Man Walking.
All right, creatures of the night, welcome to episode 68 of Talking Taker, our encyclopedic exploration, digging up the career of the greatest professional wrestling character of all. My name is Alex Doyo. I am one of your co-hosts, and I am joined, as always, by my tag team partner, my wrestling buddy, the Tennessee Titan himself, Mr. Travis White. Travis, my man, it was good to see you over Thanksgiving, and it was great to have my first ever wrestling matches with handicap matches with your two sons, man. They were you've been training them up right, dude. They know all the right moves.
I have pretty much headbutts and elbow drops and frog splashes. Sounds like they're training for MMA.
But shoulder blocks. Good.
Shoulder blocks, yeah. You five moves to do them. That's all I need, dude. You're 16-time world champion. No, man, it was great to see you. Glad we got to see each other. And yeah, like I said, you got to wrestle my boys. And one of them just kicked you the entire time.
Dude, so, he's doing the yes kicks, man.
Yeah, he was.
He was so excited, too.
He was, man. So, yeah, man, it was great. Good times. Got to see you for a little while. So, yeah, man, but here we are back in the grind. Back in thick of things. There's snow outside here in Tennessee.
Oh, really?
And yeah, weird. So, but yeah, woke up with snow on the car this morning, so it's nuts. But anyway, yeah, man, we're doing our thing. I got a little tiny creature of the night on my shoulder, so we'll see how this goes.
We will. Yeah, I'm thankful for all that you just said. Thankful we got to see each other, and I'm thankful for this particular episode of the podcast because. Whew, we're covering Armageddon 2000. There's so much to talk about here, dude. We've got a historically unique Hell in a Cell matchup.
That's a great way to put it.
Yes, yes. we've got the old patented Blood Tracker 2000 coming back into play here tonight. We've got, perhaps more importantly than all, the words I never thought I would say in my entire life. We are thankfully entering the Limp Bizkit era of The Undertaker, man. How great is it to say that?
Oh, never been so happy to hear Fred Durst in my life. Anyone who knows me know that I hate that man musically.
Personally?
As a music aficionado, I blame him for single-handedly ruining rock and roll music in the 90s and into what the 2000s became. He single-handedly destroyed it.
Coming
in
hot.
Going too far along. But I've never been so excited to hear Fred Durst coming through the speakers, man, as I was when I turned on this pay-per-view. Oh, man, no more overdubs of Dead Man Inc. or whatever it's called. Here we go. We're rolling, 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 baby.
Well, we hope so, man. It's at least intact on this pay-per-view. We'll see how intact it is going forward. But, yeah, dude, I popped huge when the Biscuit came on. And, to be honest, I used to pop huge when it came on in that era too. But it's not on heavy rotation in my CD player anymore. But dude, it was great to hear it this time.
It was, man, and I didn't realize he only had Kid Rock for like 6 months.
Yeah, I
thought he had it longer. You know, I didn't remember him getting rolling here at the end of 2000. I thought it was a little earlier in 2001. So
that's one of those things that just sticks in your head, memory wise. It leaves that mark in there as being longer than it was. But yeah, Limp Bizkit comes into play right here. But we'll get to that in a little while. Of course, we're going to do our standard coverage of everything going into this Armageddon Hell in a Cell crazy six pack challenge matchup. And there is quite a bit of it here. Some awesome promos getting into it. Oh, and just
one of the best coming up.
Oh, yeah. Hodgepodge of stuff, hodgepodge of characters. We'll try to cram it in as best we can as we head back to the night after Survivor Series, November 20th, 2000. And Travis, I'm going to be covering Raw here, but I know that you weren't watching Raw live back on this night.
I wasn't. I had to take a brief hiatus this night. Had to watch it on VHS tape delay because I was at an actual live taping of Monday Nitro.
Ooh,
so it
sleeping with Nitro, the enemy.
I guess so. Although, as we've said, I was definitely WCW born and bred. So came to WWF later on. But anyway, yeah, man, I was at this Nitro on, what was this, November 20th? Mm-hmm. It was Nitro and Thunder taping at the, what's now called the James Brown Arena in Augusta. I guess it would have been called the, what, Augusta Richmond County City Center back
then.
That's right, yeah. So, probably 3,000 people there, I would imagine, 3,500, something like that. So, and actually, in a twist of fate, you were actually supposed to attend this event with me, I believe.
Yeah, I believe I was. I don't remember the exact reasoning. We were freshmen in high school at this point, and I think I was.
I think your progress report came back. Or
yeah,
something. Yeah,
some like B's or C's or something, and my parents were super strict that point in time.
Like, yeah, your dad. I think dad or mom. Somebody said, "Nope, can't do that." Yeah, so I went with another buddy of ours, my brother's girlfriend at the time. My brother didn't want to take me, so his girlfriend at the time took me and him. So, yeah, man, it was a blast. I got to see one of my favorite WCW superstars of all time, the Kwee Wee.
Live and in color.
Kwee Wee took on Goldberg. and Mike Sanders took on Goldberg back-to-back. Main event was Lex Luger and Booker T. I really thought Sting was coming back that night. I was very hopeful. He'd been taken out by Scott Steiner recently. So, yeah, man. And again, we got a Thunder taping too. I think I got to see Chronic. I got to see tag titles change hands. Jeff Jarrett came back. He'd been on a brief hiatus. So, yeah, it was good stuff, man. Cool stuff. But, yeah, I had to watch this Raw the next day when I got home from school. So, on tape delay. So, yeah, man. It was a bummer that you and I never got to attend a WCW event together. You realize that? Never,
yeah,
ever.
I'm sure we were thinking, oh, it's all right. I'll miss this Nitro, but we'll catch them when they come back around in a few months. Oh,
exactly.
They weren't in business anymore because they were having shows with Kwee Wee versus Goldberg. And that's all you need to know about why they went out of business.
Kwee Wee goes for like a springboard, like lion salt type thing. And as he jumps in the air, turns around in the air, Goldberg spears him and takes him down. It was fantastic. Fantastic. But it was also Quibi versus Goldberg.
Yeah.
Well, anyway.
I'm very sorry I missed that, but yeah. Good times. Good times. We actually did not go to a wrestling show together until 2003. It was the first one we ever went to.
Weird. That's making sense.
Yeah. We were friends for a long time before that.
Yeah. I guess just the funds, you know? And they really didn't come around. I wasn't really a big fan of going to house shows. I like to go on TV tapings, and yeah, we didn't get a chance to go to that until 2003. I'm sure we'll cover that here eventually when we get there. So that was good stuff. We almost died that night. So yeah, it's a good story. Good stories to tell.
We'll tell that another day.
Because we lived to tell that.
We lived to tell the tale.
Almost,
that's right.
You know who also lived to tell us something the other day? Triple H. Why don't you take us to Raw that night?
Yeah, so like I said, we're going to pick up right after Survivor Series 2000, which we covered in our last show. Undertaker losing to Kurt Angle with the help of Kurt's brother, Eric Angle. And as we briefly mentioned, Triple H was murdered at that show, but was somehow upgraded to alive the next night. Stephanie comes out. She's begging Stone Cold to accept her apology to end his feud with Triple H, since her and Triple H are trying to conceive a child now. And so both those guys are going to come into play here in a little while. So just mentioning that briefly. But we did talk about how on we talked about on last week's episode, some confusion going on with that finish as Eric Angle popped up from under the ring, or Undertaker pulled him out from under the ring, and he was dressed up as his brother. The referee, Earl Hebner, was trying to count the pinfall, but stopped counting because he realized it wasn't Kurt Angle. And we're actually going to get some continuity with that. Continuity. No one wants to see that with Earl Hebner. Our investigative journalist, Michael Cole, is going to get to the bottom of it. He interviews Earl Hebner in the back and asks why Hebner didn't count to three when Undertaker was pinning Eric Angle last night. And Hebner says, well, it's pretty obvious. He can't count a three on someone who's not in the match. So there
you
go.
That's why he's a senior referee.
That's why. And then Kurt and Eric are both going to come out to cut a promo later in the night to give some more continuity to everything. And says, Kurt said that thankfully last night the fans did not have to endure yet another Survivor Series screw job like they had the past 2 years because the right person walked away with the title last night. And he says, you know, me and you were questioning why was Eric under the ring that whole time? And
yeah, really.
Kurt explains it. He says his brother was just waiting there under the ring all night to surprise him with a victory celebration after the match. And the Undertaker thoughtlessly and dangerously tossed him into the ring and abused him.
He's just waiting there in his brother's matching singlet.
Brotherly love.
To celebrate. And then going to pop out of the ring when he wins.
If any family would do that, it would be the Angle family, I
think.
That's true. Well, Taker does not buy this, so he comes out and chokeslams Eric, and then he chokeslams Kurt off the stage onto a table, venting his frustrations from the night before.
Yeah. That's how he took out Big Show a few months ago.
Apparently, yeah, that's his go-to now.
Oh, wow.
Taker's not done throwing his weight around. He's going to go to the back and demand a favor from Commissioner Foley and debut another one of his catchphrases here. We've seen it a lot over the past few weeks. I think the past three episodes he's debuted some different ones. Well, he tells Foley that Foley owes him because he made him famous.
You owe me for throwing your ass 25 feet off the top of Hell in a Cell. Oh, you just about killed me that night. Yeah, that may be true. But what I did was make you famous. You did. Okay, what can I do for you?
Like I said, I believe that's the first time we've heard him use that slogan.
So, yeah, well, he uses it later on. It comes into play with this match, Armageddon. So I was wondering when it reared its little head here. That's cool. I had no idea it came out in this episode of Raw. So do you think he's been hanging out with Rock a lot? So now he's getting these new catchphrases. He's just adding them up.
Maybe he's a little jealous of Rock.
Exactly. Yeah. He used to criticize him as being, you know, catchphrase guy, but now he's just cranking them out, dude.
I think he's a little jealous. Well, Undertaker wants to fight the Angle brothers in a handicap match, and Foley says he has got to check on their condition first. So a little bit later on, Edge and Christian come into Foley's office, and this is another really funny skit they have with him. They're apologizing to Commissioner Foley because they think they overstepped their boundaries by interfering in their acquaintance Kurt Angle's match last night. And Edge is just begging forgiveness. He talks about all the respect they have for The Undertaker's decade of destruction and points out, hey, no one has seen Kamala since Undertaker stuffed him in a casket. So, it's total respect for what he's done. Foley's like, what's your point, guys? And Christian says he wants Foley to pass along their apology, and he says that Undertaker earned that apology as Christian pulls an urn out from behind his back. And Foley says he'll pass along the gift, but it might be too late because they have earned a handicap match with The Undertaker. But it's okay, Foley says, because Undertaker will make them famous. And Edge says, more like heinous.
Dude, that was our word, man. Heinous. We
loved
that.
It, man.
We loved these guys back then.
Well, heinous. Foley does pass along the urn because we're going to see backstage Undertaker walking out for the match, and he sees the urn Edge and Christian left for them. It's got a handwritten note on it, and Undertaker picks up the urn and the note and reads it out. It says, Undertaker, for a decade of awesomeness, you totally rule, Edge and Christian. And then Taker says,
perfect.
Yeah. Taker says, looks like somebody's messing around in the dead man's yard. And then he tosses the urn in the trash in a truly symbolic moment as he throws away the dead man part of his career, I suppose.
Wow.
Yeah. Tears were shed.
I guess he did.
Yeah,
he did toss it away, man. Just, you know, he mentioned, like, what, this time last year, 99, that, you know, gone are the days of scary entrances and magic and stuff, but here he is a year later, finally putting it to bed, so.
That's right.
Pretty cool. I don't remember any of this stuff because I didn't watch this till next night. I may not have even watched it, honestly, and I may not have even skipped, I may have skipped this episode of Raw. I can't remember.
Well, Edge and Christian had so many of these hilarious things.
Yeah.
It's hard to remember all of them.
And
JR gets off something funny here. As Undertaker takes on Edge and Christian in this handicap match, we get another new nickname for The Undertaker. And, dude, this is a throwback to something we mentioned a few weeks ago, as JR calls The Undertaker the chairman of the board of Dead Man Inc. And I know me and you, we said our new nickname for Undertaker was Carrot Top. And this is just worlds colliding here, dude. This proves that he is the Carrot Top, the chairman of the board.
Is that that movie?
Yes. That movie. One of the best movies of all time.
Oh, this is God telling us that he definitely is Carrot Top.
He is
WWE. No other he truly way is Carrot this. Top. Oh, man. Wow. I didn't know when I mentioned that. Sorry. I didn't know when I mentioned that a few weeks ago that it was going to, like, actually make sense.
Very prescient of you.
Oh, wow.
Well, Carrot Top loves ragdolling around Edge and Christian, as we've mentioned, as Undertaker gives Christian another massive last ride for the pin and gives Edge a choke slam for good measure, close out that episode of Raw and take us into SmackDown.
Those poor guys, man. They bumped around for the APA and Undertaker their first year, like the first main year on the roster. I mean, seriously.
Paying their dues.
Oh, man. Whew, craziness. So, yeah, that takes us to SmackDown 66 on the 23rd of November there. This is the Thanksgiving edition of SmackDown. So, you know, it's playing on actual Thanksgiving night. So, and of course, it wouldn't be Thanksgiving SmackDown if it weren't for a backstage food fight. So, yes, ladies and gentlemen, even 18 years ago, they did that crap.
Oh, yeah.
So,
I love
they
weren't it.
Put. They didn't put the turkeys on each other's hands and punch each other like they did last week on SmackDown. But they did another stupid food fight backstage. So
I love the holiday food fights, man.
It's got to happen. Oh yeah. It's got to happen. So, but I just, it's crazy because it was even happening 18 years ago. So, yeah. We get a recap video of what happened on Monday, and then Angle comes out in a neck brace, and again his pyro goes off, and he's spooked by it. I just love little nuances that Angle has, because like we mentioned, he's nobody picked up the business faster than this guy did, and it's just amazing to see the little touches that he was aware of being so young in the business. So, and then we get an advertisement for tonight's episode of SmackDown, brought to you by WWF No Mercy for the N64. So again, as we mentioned, I personal opinion, the greatest wrestling game of all time, I think,
no
without
doubt.
Question, as Tony Schiavone was saying. So, and WCW, we brought to you by one of the worst wrestling games of all time, and that's WCW Backstage Assault.
Oof.
And this is the same time. This is just shows you the difference. This is a perfect example of the difference between WCW and WWF at this time. Because for those of you who don't know what WCW Backstage Assault was, it's the wrestling game where you literally can't wrestle in a ring. It's only backstage fights. That's the most WCW thing to do.
You know, I know what they were going for. It's not a bad idea in theory, but, oh, man, yeah, it just did not come out right.
That's got to play
out
right. Yeah. Anyway, I just had to throw that in there because we like to give a, you know, this is the story of the wrestling business and WWF in addition to Undertaker, you know. So I just thought I'd throw it in there as WCW is coming to a close here in a few months. So anyway, Angle comes out, and I'll try to wrap this up real quick. He says, you know, basically, believe it or not, you know, your Olympic hero was naive. I face Taker, pinned his shoulder to the mat, have my hand raised in victory in the past. My opponents, after I beat them, they would say, nice job, Mr. Angle. It was an honor to be in the ring with you. But he says, but you, Undertaker, if that is your real name. And he just said, how do you say that with a straight face? He's like, Undertaker, if that is your real name, you can't stand that you lost to the better man. He says, congratulations. That little piece of business from Raw just earned you the sore loser of the year. So let's face it, unlike you, I love my brother. I didn't set his face on fire and force him to wear a scary red mask for the rest of his life. And he says, you sick, twisted, and he bleeps out what he says next. I don't know what it was, but he says something that was bleeped out. Because, again, they're on UPN, so they bleep stuff out there.
Right,
so,
right.
And he's like, where are your gold medals? And then he says, you know, I've got the gold medals and the gold on my waist. And he says, if I ever see you even look at me funny, by golly, I will. And then Taker's music comes on. He comes out, and he's just kind of shaking his head at Kurt, just, you know, back and forth, just like a disappointed father, basically. It's just pretty funny to watch. Comes down, gets in his face, starts punching Angle, takes his neck brace off. Of course, Edge and Christian, the Whipping Boys run out 3-on-1. Angle's kind of just playing possum there. We see that his neck really wasn't hurt, and he slaps Taker across the face, and Taker clears the ring, and after that, we see during the break, Team Eck, there, Edge, Christian, and Kurt, they head out in the white town car. So he's gone from green sparkles to a white town car. So they get out of Dodge and get away from the Undertaker. So that's what happens there on SmackDown. Not a lot of resolution to that story.
Not a lot of resolution to that story, but it's keeping the story moving along. I know you had something you wanted to bring up about sort of the storytelling and what was going on behind the scenes at this time as far as the writing staff and how we're going to kind of see maybe the storylines sort of fall apart a little bit here towards the end of this part of 2000.
Yeah, you know, I mentioned a few weeks ago, I don't remember how many, a month ago or something, that, you know, 2000's one of my favorite years of wrestling, even in WCW. I know it gets a bad rap, but I just love this year, 2000, especially WWF. It's just firing on all cylinders, and I mentioned a few weeks ago that it's weird that Austin's gone for most of it, you know, but it's still one of my favorite years because all the new talent they have and everything. But I was doing a little research, just finding out, like, what's the deal? Like, why did I like it so much? Because, you know, Russo's gone. He and Ferrara left suddenly at the end of 99 in October. Basically what I found was that the writer during this era was Chris Kresge, which I know Bruce Prichard's talked about briefly on his podcast. So Chris Kresge was the head writer during all of 2000, and allegedly he was the one that would keep, like, storyboards of, like, storylines. So he literally had, like, drawings and storyboards in the writer's office or the writer's room about, like, who all was feuding with who and how all this intertwined. And it really goes, and if you look back at these episodes, everything really does intertwine and everything makes sense, you know, and it's really cool. I mean, even almost more so than Russo, because things aren't quite so out of control and random, you know. But Chris Kresge was the head writer, and during this time around October, November, definitely November, December, he allegedly gets demoted. This is what I could find online on the dirt sheets. He gets demoted in order for Stephanie to be promoted to head writer of WWF. Hmm. So at the time, so that he's basically the unsung hero of WWF in 2000, keeping everything afloat once Russo leaves. And but you can definitely tell his influence is reduced here. As I mentioned, you know, unfortunately, it lines up with when Austin comes back. But I feel like once Austin comes back, and after that, the storytelling just got crappy, and I guess I'm going to blame Stephanie McMahon. She's the one at the head of the helm now. And Chris Kresge stays until about 2002, then he leaves the company, and then he unfortunately passed away from cancer in 2005. But anyway, he's the guy that's keeping the ship afloat here. And yeah, man, like I said, I love this era, and I know you do too. And I just wanted to kind of find out what's different about this. Why is November and December suck compared to the rest of the year, you know?
Yeah. That's it. I will say it's one of those things where, obviously, as we've mentioned many times, we're just fans. We don't have we don't know exactly what was going on backstage and with the writing staff and all that. And obviously, like you said, Bruce Prichard has talked about it. And from what I've heard, he doesn't give Chris Kresge all that same credit that a lot of people online tend to give him for all that sort of stuff. So I'm sure the truth is somewhere in there somewhere. But to your point, you definitely can tell during this time that this stuff here, November and December, it's just not as good as it was earlier in the year. And it doesn't click as well. And that does kind of seem to happen. Like, almost every year, like the build from Survivor Series to Royal Rumble is always like one of the deadest times for WWE. As I'm going to point out here later on, the December pay per view just kind of always falls apart. Man, I don't know what it is about it, man, but it's almost never good. So who knows, man? But yeah, that's definitely a good point and something interesting to point out as we talk about the evolution here, especially the rise of Stephanie McMahon in there. Back to the in-ring stuff here. Raw, November 27th, 2000. Kurt Angle, talk about logic, man. I love this promo he has to open the show. he says what we've all been thinking this whole time. Yeah, he cuts this awesome promo saying, "Over the weekend, I gave it some thought. And being a WWF superstar means having the only profession in the world where someone can commit awful acts of violence against you and your family, not have any remorse, amazingly not get punished, and if anything, they get rewarded. What is going on, people?" He's not wrong.
I know. The coin, I mean, the to copy him. It's true. It's true, man.
It's true.
Like, seriously. He's absolutely right.
He starts ranting about Undertaker attacking him last week. Triple H masterminding a hit-and-run attack. Steve Austin basically murdering Triple H. Austin going crazy on SmackDown and says,
if that were to happen in any other organized sport, whether it be amateur or professional, that would be a national scandal.
That is.
But here, it's just another day at the office. Well, I, for one, have had it.
That's great.
Oh, he's so good.
Telling the truth, man.
I know.
Kurt says that if these acts of violence continue on, that he's going to leave. He's going to head home. And Commissioner Foley comes out along with Lieutenant Commissioner Deborah. And this is kind of the... yeah, exactly. That's sort of the genesis of what's going on here. Really the underlying storyline of all of this is that Commissioner Foley is letting things get out of control. And we're going to see Vince McMahon come back and get angry with him over the next few weeks and have this power grab between the two of them over who's really controlling the WWF, and that's where the Hell in a Cell is going to come into play here. Later on, Edge and Christian Foley is going to have Angle have a mystery opponent tonight for the WWF Championship. Edge and Christian are in the back with Kurt drinking their sodas, and they're trying to figure out...
Sodas rule.
Exactly. they're trying to figure out who Kurt might face tonight, so Edge and Christian offer some suggestions like...
Kurt, there is the obvious, but maybe Foley won't go there. I mean, who else have you ticked off lately?
You did break Hardcore Holly's arm and never apologized. My card got lost in the mail. What are you talking about?
Guys.
There was the time that you thought S.A. Rios was the valet and you told him to get your car... Oh, that was ugly.
Guys.
Like he didn't need the extra work. Think about it.
Guys, check this out.
But Christian notices Undertaker on the security camera walking into the building and spitting tobacco on the floor, as natural, and says, holy rematches, Kurt. Foley's going to make you fight the Undertaker tonight. That's actually not what happens, though. Kurt Angle gets freaked out, so he goes and tries to sweet-talk Kane in the back. You know, trying to reignite the Kangle tag team here. Tells Kane how great his Thanksgiving was. Oh, my favorite. I always call him that. And he's trying to plant the seeds of hatred again between Kane and Undertaker. He says, I bet Undertaker didn't even call you this Thanksgiving. And he says, Kane, you can come over anytime to my family for Thanksgiving and Christmas. You can help trim the tree or light the menorah if that's your thing. And then Kurt and Kane go off to talk some more. We've never talked about their religion, Kane and Undertaker's religion. Maybe they are Jewish.
Maybe. I mean, Kane, I guess he could be. Who knows?
Well, Kurt's plan works as we see Undertaker working on his bike backstage, and Kane comes barreling into the frame out of shot, screaming, I think he says, hi, big brother. I had to rewind it like 3 times. I can't really tell what he yells. Something about brother. And just starts pounding on Undertaker. Edge and Christian and Kurt.
He says, hi, big brother.
I think that's what he said. Edge and Christian and Kurt are watching backstage, just laughing and smiling all this. And we find out that Undertaker, because of this, is going to fight Kane later in the night. So they have a fun little match with each other on TV. But Edge and Christian and Angle interfere just as Undertaker's about to hit the last ride. And then Team Eck return to the locker room laughing, excited that their plan has worked out. But Foley is very pissed off at all of this. He says he's tired of Angle talking about integrity and then interfering in all of these matches. And books Kurt Angle against Stone Cold later on in the night. So they have a match with each other as Kurt's punishment for all of this. And you're starting to see how all these different guys are starting to flow together into this one big match here eventually.
Yeah, well, yeah, that's why we're talking about all these guys so much, is because it's all going to build. Again, we're having a 6-man Hell in a Cell here as the show we're covering. So, yeah, it's kind of why we're spending time focusing on Kurt Angle and Rock and Rikishi, and, well, we will get to Hunter and Austin and stuff. So, yeah, a lot of stuff, a lot of storylines interweaving here. So that'll take us to SmackDown 67, November 30th, and we see it opens up. It's really cool. It opens up with these 5 different, like, earlier tonight segments. And basically, it's Foley in his little quote-unquote office, and he tells Rikishi, you know, you're going to get a title shot. And you get Rikishi's reaction. He tells Triple H same thing. Tells Taker. Tells Rock. And tells Austin. So he's got all five of these guys, but they're not one on one. It's just like, you know, five different little segments, but they play them in a row. It's really cool to see. And it's funny because in Taker, since we're focusing on him, he says,
"So let me get this straight. It's for the WWF title, right?
Yeah.
Well, hell, that's all you had to say."
He didn't put his fingers up in the air and moonwalk out or anything like you said you started doing last month, but he was excited.
Because he didn't have those pants on.
Exactly. He didn't have his dancing pants on. So, but yeah, so it's really cool just seeing those five guys in the office separately with Foley. And really cool way to open the show different, you know, different than something else. So
yeah. This
episode is brought to you by Dario SmackDown 2 Know Your Role. So got a little promotions for their video games. Again, another classic PlayStation game. So fantastic. We spent many an hour playing that game. So good stuff. Foley comes out for a promo where I just wrote, "We're probably going to take a international flight to go next door." That's a Steve Richards saying. So the last several hundred of these, it takes 25 minutes to get to the point. So
that's a great way to put it.
Yeah. I borrowed that from Stevie Richards. He says it's like taking an international flight to get next door. So
suck it up to the right to censor yet again.
There I am. Exactly. Laying the seeds for a resurgence. You know, it is a very politically correct world we live in nowadays, so it's about time for them to come back.
Why not? At this point, dude.
Yeah, we can get the, you know, old man's match at Saudi Arabia, so might as well bring back the RTC. So,
dude, that would actually probably get over huge because what is the biggest thing that wrestling fans our age say is like, "Oh, hit PG era, we can just go back to Attitude era." So you had like the PG Police, Right to Censor coming out. It'd be monster heels, dude. Yeah. I could see it.
It would be. It'd be great, man.
I could see it.
See,
why not?
Good stuff. So they come out. He comes out and he says, "You know, after Monday, my eyes are open even wider to a few things." He said, "Number one, Angle's a conniving, devil-talking, sniveling liar." So I appreciate it. He must have pulled his thesaurus out that day because those are some good words there.
He's an author.
So yeah, that's true. He is. And then he says, "Number two, Angle is right about the WWF with regards to the violence this year." He's like, "We got, you know, forklifts dropping people. We got hit and runs. We got choke slams off the stage." He didn't mention anything about like Undertaker throwing the Big Show off of with like a chain wrapped around his neck, or I don't know, Shane McMahon plummeting to his death off of a SummerSlam thing. He didn't mention those things, but anyway, or of course the Edge Jeff Hardy spear. No one's going to mention that. Get off my soapbox here. But anyway, he says the number one contenders match ended in a DQ. A rematch would just end up in a screw job. He says, "So screw the screw job. I'm going to make it five number one contenders." So I like that, you know, screw the screw jobs. Let's just get right to it. So
let's do it.
You got five number one contenders. He says the first one's The Rock. So Rock comes out, and I want to point this out. This is really – I had to go back and rewind it. So when Rock comes out, you know, they always zoom into the crowd with all the posters they hold and stuff. And we see a poster in the audience that says, "I Fear Lesnar" on it.
Really?
So I was just like, whoa, that's a year and a half before he even comes to the – WWF. I mean, he must have been in developmental at this point or something. I don't know, but go back, SmackDown 67. I don't remember the timestamp, but when Rock comes out for this promo with Foley, there's a guy in the audience says, "I fear Lesnar." So I just like, man, that guy had no idea what he was gonna, like, what that was going to mean, you know, years later. So thought that was kind of cool.
Have you seen the one? It pops up on Reddit every few months. There's like a 2003 SmackDown or something. Somebody has a sign in the crowd. It says something like "Matt Hardy will be deleted" or something like that.
Oh no, that's like, cool.
I don't know what it was all about or something, but something during that V1 era, someone got a sign that said that, and that's just like one of those crazy time traveling
like coincidence thing. Yeah, that's weird. Well, we have one of those guys here when The Rock comes out, so that's pretty cool, man. I'd never seen that, but
yeah.
Yeah, anyway, Lesnar was striking fear in the people's souls back in 2000 as well. So
talking about him soon.
Yeah, we sure will. So Rock comes out, does his shtick with Foley. You know, they're always good together. And he's like, you know, "I want my title shot. Since I'm number one contender, I want it at Armageddon." So Foley's like, "Yeah, it sounds great." And he brings out another person that was screwed at Survivor Series. That's the Undertaker. So Taker comes out, and he gets in the ring, and he just yanks Foley's mic out of his hand, which is awesome. Foley's like, what the heck? So Taker, he's short and simple. He goes, I have no idea what it is you're talking about, but if it involves me getting a title shot at Angle, I'm all about that. So I just love that. This dude doesn't care. It's great, man. Next, we get Austin coming out to a just enormous pop, and he takes the mic from Foley again. That's kind of the story here. They're kind of ripping the mic out of Foley's hand. So, and he just basically says what something I could not agree more with. He goes, let's get to the bottom line. Seriously.
Then, yes.
Yeah. Foley calls out Rikishi, who just comes to the top of the ramp. And then Foley says, Triple H, get out here. Hunter comes out. And then Foley tells them all, you know, all of your lives have intertwined recently, and he's getting sick of it. And he basically says, you know, to settle this, we're going to have a six-person Hell in a Cell match at Armageddon. So that's where they announce it. It's on this episode of SmackDown, so which I couldn't remember. Which it's, I mean, it's creeping up on the pay-per-view here. So
yeah.
We're, what, 10 days away, I think, or
right.
Something? So, yeah, so this brings out Kurt Angle, and he's ticked off. You know, he's like, Mick, you've lost your mind. You know, we've just talked about all this danger is going on, and why are you going to put me in this Hell in a Cell? So Mick is like, you know, I've got no alternative. And there's no other, you know, solution. And if any of you guys get involved in each other's matches tonight, you'll be out of the match, Armageddon. So then Triple H brings out Stephanie, and they hug, and he's like, you know, tonight's our one-year wedding anniversary. So everyone – so which I couldn't remember that. So he's like, you know, everyone's invited, especially Austin, since you missed it last year. So – thought that was a neat little day at Austin. So, main event this night is Edge, Christian, and Angle versus Rock and Taker in a handicap match. And the match ends when Taker hits a choke slam on Angle, followed by the Last Ride. So, gets a clean win on Kurt Angle, the champion.
On the champ,
so,
yeah.
Yeah. And that leads us to Rebellion.
Well, like we said last week, we're not going to devote an entire episode to Rebellion 2000. I'm going to break our rule here of covering every Undertaker pay-per-view match, and we have covered all the previous UK pay-per-views, but this one's a little bit different. You know, there's not as much continuity here with what's going on the Raws and SmackDowns and everything else, and more importantly than that, it's Undertaker in a singles match against Chris Benoit, and as we'll discuss one day down the road, you know, Travis and I both still don't really enjoy watching Chris Benoit's work anymore in the ring, and obviously that's the least important consequence of Chris Benoit's actions back in 2007, but it's the truth, man. I just don't enjoy, I don't go back and watch any of his matches anymore. Used to be both of our favorite wrestlers, and we traveled to New York City in 2004 to watch him win the main event at WrestleMania. It was an awesome moment, and yeah, everything that happened afterward totally sucks. That's no other way to put it. And so, yeah, just long story short, wouldn't be a fun episode to cover that. No offense to anybody else. If you do still enjoy watching his work and if you can separate it, I just personally don't. And Travis, I know you don't really either. But just to let you know what goes on there in that match, Undertaker gets ambushed by all of the Radicals on the way to the ring. Which, just watching these Raws and SmackDowns, like, they came in what, January, February 2000?
February.
They were a faction, then they broke up, and then they're all back together again here by November of 2000. It's weird. Anyway.
Yeah.
But they ambush him, Undertaker on the way to the ring and work over his leg. Benoit comes out first, and then they have to play Undertaker's music three times before he comes out limping to the ring. And the finish comes when Benoit attempts a figure four on the Undertaker and reverses it with an inside cradle. And Taker gets a three count and a pin over Chris Benoit. So there
That's
you go. You can feel free to go watch it and let us know how you feel about it. But we're going to move on.
Yep.
So Raw, December 4th, 2000, only 3 weeks to build to Armageddon. So this is the Raw go-home show going into there. And we're going to see something I love. The show actually kicks off with a match instead of one of those 20-minute promos. I always love when that happens during these days. Undertaker is going to face Rikishi here one-on-one. And King gets maybe the line of the night here as he says that,
Rikishi, he breaks that 11th commandment every day. Thou shalt not weigh more than your refrigerator.
Oh my golly. it's out of control. He's supposed to be the heel, like heel commentator. He's bashing on the quiche, man.
I don't know which version of the Bible that's in, but it's one of those.
Sorry.
That's an inside joke right there.
That's on Dead Sea Scrolls.
Well, anyway, oddly enough, Rikishi's actually going to get a semi-clean pinfall over The Undertaker here. Kurt Angle's going to come out and provide a distraction, although he doesn't actually... he doesn't get physical with Undertaker. Undertaker gets physical with Angle. So I'll call that, you know, that's Undertaker's fault. He did that to himself here. So Rikishi gets a super kick and a bonsai drop and a three count on The Undertaker going into Armageddon. So Angle gets in the ring afterward, and him and Rikishi are laying the boots down to Taker after the match. And I'm going to try to sum all this up because there's so much happening on this episode of Raw. But basically, the heels and the baby faces are going to kind of split off here in this match. You've got Triple H, Rikishi, and Kurt on the heel side. Kurt and all these guys are going to meet backstage. They're going to try to be thinking about working together. Triple H and the Big Brown Machine, Rikishi, are already teaming up with each other. And Kurt wants to get in with them, you know, work together. He wants to call themselves the Three Musketeers.
Perfect.
Yeah, it's great. Meanwhile, all the baby faces are kind of doing their own thing. Rock delivers one of his most famous promos ever here, the one where he does impressions of all five of these guys.
One of the best. I was jealous that you got to watch that. It's so good.
You've all seen it. You've all remember it. And, of course, he does a classic Undertaker impression as part of that.
Waterwalk. That's my favorite one.
Just savages all of these guys. Undertaker's going to do his best Ron Simmons impression as he walks out of Mick Foley's office and just says, "Damn."
Hey, whoa. So is Undertaker responsible for Ron Simmons' catchphrase?
He is.
Is that what we're saying here?
Put it on the list.
Oh, you just made the list.
We don't see what they were talking about here, but we just see Foley apologizing, saying he's going to make it up to Undertaker on SmackDown. So maybe you can fill us in on that here in a second. But yeah, chuck that one up. Triple H and Rikishi do not help Kurt Angle in his match against Chris Jericho after telling him that they would think about it. So, you know, there's some tension in there with their alliance. And the other big thing is we're going to see Vince McMahon come back into play here on this episode. As I mentioned earlier, he does these skits backstage with all the baby faces, basically trying to convince them, talk them out of competing in this barbaric Hell in a Cell matchup, saying it's not good for them, it's not good for the WWF. And we see Taker... see Vince talking to Taker about this. Vince is actually sitting on Undertaker's bike and checking it out, revving the engine. Yeah, big no-no there. Taker walks up and informs Vince he needs to get his butt off of that bike. And Vince tells Taker, you know, think about Hell in a Cell. Tell Mr. Foley you don't want to compete in it. And Undertaker says, well, why don't you give Mick Foley a message for me? And then proceeds to spit his tobacco juice onto Vince McMahon's jacket.
And goodness gracious.
Says, tell Commissioner Foley you need a new jacket. So, message received.
Oh, my. Love it. He doesn't give a crap.
God, it's so gross. Never say Vince won't take one for the team there.
It's true, man.
As Vince comes out, at the end of the night, the main event, quote-unquote, is Vince delivering a State of the World Wrestling Federation address, complete with the tobacco stain still on his jacket here. Vince says he regrets his decision to hire Foley as commissioner. Him and Linda are going through marital counseling, and he forgives Linda for hiring Mick, but he cannot forgive Mick for his actions. So Mick comes out, he defends himself against Vince. Austin comes out and gives Vince a stunner. Rock comes out and gives Vince a rock bottom. Undertaker comes out and stares down the Rock before coming into the ring. Then he hands his hat and sunglasses to Commissioner Foley as Vince McMahon is slowly getting back up to his feet and takes that patented just big gulp in his throat. And Taker shakes his head and gives McMahon a very painful looking last ride.
Oh, yeah. They replay that on SmackDown. It looked awful.
Again, taking one for the team.
Vince is 55 years old right there, man.
Gosh.
Golly. Taking a last ride at 55 years old.
Well, I'm glad he didn't almost drop him like he did Regal last week. Yeah,
for real.
Well, Foley then gives him maybe the most devastating move as he puts Mr. Sacco on Vince to finish him off here. And
oh, man.
Something tells me this is not going to end well for Commissioner Foley. But it's not over yet as we cut to the back after this really long segment. But as the show ends and we see all of a sudden Undertaker is fighting with Kurt Angle in the back, but Triple H comes in for the save along with Rikishi, and the Three Musketeers leave Undertaker for dead, if you will. And the camera pans out, and we see that these three guys have already gotten to The Rock and Austin. They've already been attacked. They're already bleeding, busted open, so you can take the blood tracker. I guess up to two right there. Two or three. I'll have to double check. I'm not sure if Undertaker was bleeding too. But Raw goes off the air with the line in the sand drawn between these six Hell in a Cell competitors, as King calls this group an unholy alliance. And I guess he's reusing.
Whoa. Yeah.
That's what Undertaker and Big Show were, bro.
Yeah. What the heck? You can't just take that from them. There's nothing unholy about them.
No. They're the Three Musketeers, man. Yeah. It's a much better name.
You know what? I only know one of the Musketeers' names. Do you know the three names?
You've got one more than me.
Oh, D'Artagnan. That's the only one I know.
Okay.
So, I don't know the other two.
No anyway. Idea. Someone will correct us on Twitter.
Sure. That's fine. I don't really care. I don't need to know.
One of my least favorite candy bars, to be sure.
Oh, absolutely.
Gross. Yeah,
that thing is... Might as well flush them. So, anyway, that's going to take us to the go-home show.
Yeah, that was a lot.
Dude, that is a freaking packed episode of Raw you had there. Man, that's a lot of stuff crapping right there. Anyway, so that takes us to SmackDown 68 on December 7th, 2000. The go-home edition for Armageddon is on D-Day here in the United States.
Wow.
I just thought that was pretty fitting. Those of you who don't know what D-Day is, go look it up. Those of you who might not be in the States, kind of a big day here. But anyway, also my nephew's birthday. But anyway... I thought it was kind of cool how it lined up with Armageddon being on the go-home show on D-Day. So the show opens with a limo pulling up, and we get Angle, Stephanie, Triple H, and Rikishi getting out, which that made more sense to me now that I know what happened on Raw. So Foley comes up, and he tells Triple H and Rikishi they're suspended for the night because of what happened on Raw, and Angle's going to have a title defense here, and they're in Madison Square Garden. So it's like, you're going to defend your title here in MSG. And it's going to be a fatal four-way with Angle defending against Taker, Rock, and Austin. So that's a huge match.
Definitely.
I'll get to that. Yeah, I'll get to that in just a minute. So basically Angle's up against the wall because he's the only bad guy there. So, and then they recap that amazing promo from Raw, from The Rock. And then Steve Austin comes out, and he runs down the fact that he's ready for Sunday, basically, and says, you know, and a really cool, and I've mentioned this several times, he gives his promo, and he runs his opponents down for, you know, kind of like Rocket on Monday, but he puts him over, too, in the process of his promo here, you know, basically saying it's not going to be easy to beat these guys, but he doesn't just walk all over them and say he's going to beat them like they're a joke, because if you do that and you beat somebody, then who did you beat, you know? So
true.
It's just classic promo stuff. You don't want to just run your opponent down to their meaningless, because then you didn't beat anybody. So Austin's such a freaking pro. He knows what to do, so he puts them all over, which is really cool, so... But I specifically want to point out, when he gets to talking about Taker, he's like, you know, he talks about how brutal Hell in a Cell is, and how Taker's been in three of them. And he says, you know, Shawn's no longer with us in the company. Foley's now retired and the commissioner. And he doesn't mention Boss Man, so. But it's that, you know, neither of those guys even made it through after Hell in a Cell, basically. So I like, you know, that's not technically true that they, you know. And in fact, Sean won that match against Taker. But anyway,
revisionist history.
It's fine though; it plays into the story. It's going to play into more as we get on to actual Armageddon. So, Kurt Angle comes out, interrupts Austin, and he starts talking. And as he starts talking, Austin just starts throwing beer cans at him. He just grabs a beer can from a cooler and throws it at him. And Angle's like, what? He just kind of stutters, and Austin just lets him talk again, and he just throws another beer can at him. He does about five or six beer cans, and finally Angle just throws up his hands and leaves. So, I mean, I know it was probably a planned segment, but it looked like one of those after the night's over segments where they just, like, do stuff. Because it was just so funny to see that happen. So, and then, in something stupid, backstage we get Edge and Christian and Angle. No, I'm sorry, Edge and Christian. They're talking with Ashton Kutcher in a scene from basically promoting Dude, Where's My Car? They're like, you know, they're asking him for something. And he's like, yeah, it's like, I'm here to promote Dude, Where's My Car? And they're like, I don't know where your car is. And it's just one of those, you know, who's on first type things. And it reeks of heinosity, to borrow a Edge and Christian line. So I never was an Ashton Kutcher fan. But that movie made me laugh, I guess. That one scene about...
Dude, what's your say?
Dude? Yeah. You say sweet. Yeah, that's about it. Other than that.
So you did see that movie?
Absolutely, I did. DVD.
Yeah, do you remember your parents not letting you go see it with me?
Oh, was I supposed to see it in theater with you?
It was me, you, and another one of our friends from high school, Garrett. We were supposed to go see Dude, Where's My Car? And you and your mom showed up to the theater, and you were like, ah, my mom's not letting me go see the movie. Like, I guess it was PG-13. I don't think
maybe,
it was R.
I don't know.
Maybe it was. But, like, something in there she thought was not okay for you to go see.
I forgot about that. There was another movie that happened to me with around that time, too. I had to go see Teaching Mrs. Tingle instead. I don't remember what it was. I don't know what I was supposed to see. I saw Teaching Mrs. Tingle instead.
That one was okay?
Yeah, I guess so. Or maybe I was supposed to see that. And I don't know. I just remember I had a ticket stub for that movie. So anyway, I don't know why I couldn't see Dude, Where's My Car. But anyway, yeah. I eventually saw it on DVD and regretted it. It was terrible. But for the time, it made me laugh as a 16-year-old, whatever.
Yeah. Man, Ashton Kutcher, or Ben Stiller first, and now Ashton Kutcher appearing on Talking Taker.
Yeah, man.
Who knew?
Absolutely. So this is the episode where Vince McMahon comes out and says he wants a divorce from Linda and sends her crying to the back. Again, her acting skills are so bad. But he also says if anyone gets seriously injured on Sunday, he talks about he and Foley have a little conversation, and Foley says if anyone gets seriously injured at Hell in a Cell, he'll resign as commissioner. So that's – I'm not going to go through all what they talked about, but that's basically the gist of it. So Babyface Coach interviews Taker backstage about the Hell in a Cell, and Taker's like, you know, it's the only match where winning is secondary to surviving, which that's a kind of a cool concept, you know. He says you got to be able to put your career on the line, and with five other guys in there, anything can happen, and probably will. And he says to find out who the real bad A is, he's like, you know, you're looking at him right here. So, as I mentioned earlier, the main event's that Fatal 4-Way. It's a quick sprint of a match. Really, basically, it's fun because Angle's just the whipping boy for all three of the good guys. You know, he's just kind of bouncing off like a ping pong ball from all of them. But
yeah,
the end comes when Triple H and Rikishi, who again, remember, they were suspended, they come over the barricade and interfere. There's kind of a schmoz finish, and they take out Taker on the announce table and then bring a steel chair into the ring. Taker winds up going for a chokeslam on Rikishi, but Triple H lays him out as well. The Three Musketeers, rather, then pose as the three good guys are face down on the canvas. And then Angle turns on his partners and nails Rikishi with the title. And then Triple H turns and nails Angle with the chair and then hits a neckbreaker on Austin on the chair because Hunter must pose. Bruce Pritchard always says that Hogan must pose. So I just wrote, this is the era where Hunter must pose.
Definitely.
So, do you remember when he tried to get the neckbreaker over as a finisher?
When he came back in?
I dug it.
I liked that, too.
Yeah, I liked that.
Didn't quite catch on, but I liked it.
No, I was a fan of that, though, man. So, yeah, he does it to Austin at the end of this, and that's how we go off the air. Because, again, like I said, Hunter's got to stand strong going into pay-per-view.
Well, yeah, man. And you've seen in these last two Raws and SmackDowns, they're really trying to push the story for this main event into overdrive here. And, gosh, as we get into this Armageddon 2000 here, It really is. If you try to think back, I was trying to remember, I definitely at that time was like blown away at this match that you've got a Hell in a Cell with six guys in it. All these guys.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, five superstars and Rikishi in there.
Right.
Still, that's a crazy match. And it's for a B show, for a, like a non-major pay-per-view. They're throwing that out there on like right. such short notice. I don't really know what the story is backstage, like why they felt they needed to go with such a huge match, but it really is. I mean, it's a massive match. I guess you can kind of trace the evolution of really trying to make these lesser pay-per-views, trying to build them up into something bigger here with doing something like this.
I guess so, man. And as when we, as soon as we get into covering the show, it definitely does. When you put all six of these guys in this one match, though, it definitely limits the rest of the card, you know, because you got your six, well, five of your top guys and Rikishi. Sorry, pal, but she's not working. But you got six of your top guys there in this one match, and you know, that definitely takes away from the rest of the card. It allows other people to shine, I guess, on the card, but I don't know. It's definitely limiting. It's not like they had two separate rosters like they do nowadays, right. You know. So nowadays they can't get anyone on the show but the same guys because they do, you know, co-promoted shows or whatever. So anyway, it's like the opposite back then. So, but yeah. I don't think I remember renting this because I wanted to see the big spot, you know, from it. But I don't know if I've ever seen the rest of the show. So
it's definitely got one of the best posters of all time. With, dude, like, Undertaker riding the bike through
Sons of Anarchy, man, yeah, right through Alabama.
It says,
"Lord, I'm coming home to you," which is just. You know, could we go back to Lord of Darkness thing? I don't know, man.
I didn't think of that.
Stretching. I'm reaching there. But, yeah, it's a great poster, man. Again, once again, Taker's front and center on it.
So. Well, you just mentioned guys shining, not having room on the card to shine or anything. One guy that was shining right now was Dean Malenko, one of my favorite superstars of all time. I don't know where else to throw this in, but during this time, I think it was on the SmackDown you covered, or maybe on the Raw I covered, one or the other. Dean Malenko's been doing this feud with Lita of late.
Dirty Dean.
Feud, sort of. Exactly.
I'm gonna call him Dirty Dean.
Well, that's the thing. Dean Malenko, maybe the second greatest cruiserweight of all time, along with Rey Mysterio. I'll make that argument right there. Probably my second favorite of all time. One of the best wrestlers ever. One of the most underrated wrestlers ever. Has come to the WWF and has become the Godfather light, basically.
Yeah.
He's coming out with his ladies, if you will, every week, and has been romancing Lita. And so, I can't remember which episode it is, but they do this thing where he has won a date with Lita.
That. One of the last two SmackDowns I covered.
Okay.
Yeah. What you're about to talk about, I think.
And he ends up getting Lita in his hotel room. And I definitely remember this because I remembered exactly what Lita was wearing at this moment. I was a big fan of it. Big fan of it. And Dean is seducing her in his underwear and then gets beat up by the Hardy Boys here. At one point, one of these weeks, he beats up Lita, runs a door into her head, and then all the radicals beat her up. It's so ridiculous, man, and I just had to nominate it for our Vince Russo Memorial Broman of the Week here because it just seemed it's so out of place. You've got Dean freaking Malenko trying to make him into Dirty Dean, like you said.
Dean done dirt cheap, man.
I get that it worked for Eddie Guerrero in China, but it worked for them, and is
right,
not working
right.
for friggin' Dean Malenko.
Doesn't mean you can insert any radical and do it. Yeah,
just makes my
makes
my heart hurt for Dean.
Yeah, well, Dean Malenko. Like, let me go back to what you said about being a phenomenal cruiserweight. He was such an in WCW. He was such an outstanding performer that my brother, who was a casual, is. An understatement to how little of a wrestling fan he was.
Yes, yes.
He loved Dean Malenko. He loved Dean and Jericho were his two favorites, and Scott Hall. Those were like his three guys that he cared about. Anytime I was watching, he'd watch with me like that. Those were the three guys. So like that just goes to show like how outstanding the performances he put on. That was back when he was the Iceman. He had no personality. Yeah. All he did was freaking wrestle, and murder people in the ring is amazing. So, yeah, man, it's weird to see him. It's uncomfortable to watch him in these. You can tell he's uncomfortable.
But, oh, God, yeah.
Now he's working backstage and
still there.
Doing, making a paycheck, dude. So,
Hall
yeah,
of Famer, in my opinion.
Oh, absolutely. And I definitely say that is definitely our bromance of the week. We did not have one last week. We took a week off for Thanksgiving for bromance. Actually, there was really nothing much to talk about.
Yeah, not too much
on him. But this definitely, when I watched that, I was like, this, we got to talk about this. So,
I didn't once again,
my notes. I was going to bring it up, but you brought it up, and yeah, we had the same idea. So.
Yeah, Vince Russo did not write all that, ladies and gentlemen.
Nope.
And Jay Stanley, also a huge Dean Malenko fan, one of his favorite
wrestlers. Yes, he is.
Got to throw that out there. All right, so let's talk about Armageddon 2000.
Let's do it. Let's talk about it.
All right.
Let's talk about it. This... <Go. laughs> All right, ready? Go. All right, let's talk about it. So I want to say this, man. Well, I'll let you talk about the December pay-per-view first before we break down the actual music that accompanies this show.
Well, it's December 10th, 2000 from Birmingham, Alabama. And it's the, apparently you said it's the only WWF pay-per-view ever held in Alabama.
As far as I could tell, man.
Wow,
again,
that's crazy.
Me, people can, you know, correct me. Again, I'm not an expert, but from what I was digging through the archives and going through, you know, and typing in Alabama and WWF pay-per-view, I couldn't find any other pay-per-view from Alabama. They obviously have shows and live shows and
yeah,
tapings and stuff. I could never find any other pay-per-view from Alabama. So, as far as I know, this is the only one.
So. Well, hopefully we can break our December curse because, man, looking back at some of the matches we covered in December shows, we had the casket match with Mabel, the other Armageddon match, the Armageddon Rules Ooh. Match with the Executioner, a really stupid match with Jeff Jarrett that Jeff Jarrett somehow defeated The Undertaker in, and that dreadful Buried Alive match with Austin, 1998.
Everything went wrong.
So we're 0 for 4 on December matches so far.
Well, we'll see what this does.
Yeah, we'll
so,
see.
Can't get much worse than those. So, man... Yeah, that's, I didn't realize December sucked so bad.
Oh, man.
It's been a long December, I guess we could say.
Great song.
There's reason to believe that maybe this year will be better than the last.
Well, we got another great song here as this opening video package. It's got all six dudes, kind of footage of them, along with some explosions and some pole dancers going on. So,
dude, that's like, it reminds me of like Fight Club where you insert like the like subliminal messages.
Yeah.
Anyway.
But it's the first use, I believe, of that song. They've used it for, they use it for December pay-per-views a lot. I think they've used it for other stuff too. The end is here. Sort of like the Doors thing that Jim Johnston does.
The end is my favorite Doors song, and this is definitely an homage to that, if you will.
Yeah,
but
it's great.
It's so good, man. This could play in movies, and like I really think this is one of his best pieces of work.
Absolutely.
As far as just encapsulating the theme of this pay per view and the story and stuff. So I love it. So really good. But then that promo goes off. It's a phenomenal song. And then, if you're watching actually on the like on pay-per-view at this time, you would have heard Leonard Skinner's "Sweet Home Alabama." But in real, but on the network, we get this lame karaoke-fied Muzak version of "Sweet Home Alabama." Almost sounds like the Werewolves of London mashup that Kid Rock did.
Yeah.
What song was that? Yeah, it's
All Summer Long.
All Summer Long, yeah. It's so bad, this version on network. And but I went back and saw evidence and video of it actually being Leonard Skinner. I guess they just didn't get the royalties, yeah. And
because I remember this karaoke version, so maybe that's on the VHS even, too. Because I definitely remember this. I remember it having a crappy cover. I don't remember the Leonard Skinner version, but yeah, I didn't realize that was out there.
Well, I think it was Daily Motion I watched, unless somebody just dubbed it over and I'm mistaken. As far as I could tell, they had the actual one because they keep mentioning it all night. Sweet Home Alabama. And
right.
JR has mentioned stuff about that, and you see it throughout the night. We hear this lame-o cover version of it. But if it was, I apologize. But as far as, unless, like I said, unless somebody hoodwinked me on Daily Motion and they spliced in the real version, I could have gotten got, as Booker T would say. So that's okay. But anyway, regardless, it's terrible. This version is so bad.
Yeah, it's not good. No.
Yeah, like, really bad. How do you ruin an iconic song? You just Muzak it. You know, make it
terrible.
That's
the way to do it. We get some build-up to this match on the pay-per-view itself. We see a clip from Sunday Night Heat earlier on in the night of Foley once again reiterating that if someone is seriously injured tonight, then he will resign as the commissioner. And we also see the Stooges letting Vince McMahon know as he arrives that this was so stupid. Like, Mick Foley does have the Hell in a Cell above the ring. He really did it. Right. Like he wasn't going to do it. And Vince is pissed off about it.
In case you're blind. So, yeah, the cell is here, man. So, the cell is here. Like, is that that? And then we see Lillian backstage. Angle's doing squats in his in his locker room. And Lillian comes in. She's like, this is your make or break moment of your career coming up. And Angle's, he goes on gloating about winning gold medals and says, you know, I'm not sweating an eyebrow or a nose or a bad A or a fat A or a redneck. So he goes on his own little mocking of just like Rock did. So I thought it was pretty cool.
Like
he calls him an eyebrow and Triple H is just a nose. That's great. So, and he says, you know, I'm not worried about being made famous tonight like Foley was in Hell in a Cell because I'm already famous because I'm a gold medalist and WWF champion.
And after I win this match, with my victory and my career well in hand, I'm going to take a shower, down a nice cool glass of 99% fat-free milk, and hop on the first plane out of here. And that, Lillian, is true. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have some more training to do.
What a better way to... Can you find a better way to end a promo than that?
No. A better way to celebrate.
He's so good. 99% fat-free milk. I don't know how he does all this stuff without laughing. He's so funny.
Rikishi cuts a promo. It's pointless, as every promo he ever cut was. And then the...
Hold on. Rikishi just got burned by you.
I don't care. I'm not scared. I ain't scared. Bring it.
He's a Hall of Famer, you know.
Yeah, I know. Well, I want to put this next promo from The Undertaker in the Hall of Fame. Man, this
was
the highlight of the night, the highlight of this build-up. This was awesome. It's a promo from earlier in the day of Undertaker and Kevin Kelly inside the Hell in a Cell in the empty arena this afternoon, and it's just awesome. I can't put it over enough. Mm-hmm. Go seek it out if you've never seen it before. If I can find it on YouTube or Daily Motion or something, I'll put it up.
We'll put it online.
On social media. But if not, it's on the network. It's on the pay-per-view. Go find it. But Undertaker, he's building up. He basically tells the story of his other two Hell in a Cell matches. He says he has visions of what he's done in the past to men inside this cell, and he has to reckon with what he's going to have to do tonight to win the championship because the Hell in a Cell brings out a side of him that scares even himself, a side more animal than human, and that he craves the feeling of taking another man, ripping his face off, grinding it against the steel until the flesh is gone and all that's left is blood. And then they start interspersing it with clips from the other Hell in a Cell matches, stuff with Shawn Michaels, stuff with Mick Foley. Taker talks about the more Shawn Michaels bled, the more I wanted him to bleed, too, and the inner animal in him coming out. And this was just, oh my gosh, man, I don't know why this was not on Raw or SmackDown. It's in the middle of the pay-per-view, and this did more than anything to sell me on this match. But I've already bought the pay-per-view.
Exactly. I don't even think it was on Heat. It's on the actual pay-per-view.
Right,
so.
Yeah.
It's crazy, man. Yeah, he talks about the infamous, what he calls the chokeslam from Hellspot. It took place with Mankind in 98, and then we see a video clip of that. And these video clips are like, they're in black and white, I don't know why, but it makes it seem cooler that way, you know? It's like, almost like it's him dreaming about it, but it's just really cool when he says, you know, that was the most vicious I've ever felt. And then we see in the table spot as well, and then he says that,
do you know what the scariest part of this side of me is? It's that I like it. This is the side of me that made Mick Foley famous. This is the side that made Shawn Michaels even more famous. So the only thing left to wonder about is who I'm going to make famous tonight.
He looks up at the cell, and that's kind of how it goes off. And man, you and I both in our notes wrote that we love this so much. It's just, this was amazing. Like, great storytelling, yeah. Great continuity, great callbacks, you know, just, and it also just really putting over the cell structure itself.
Yes,
and what
it
does to a man
to
that gets in it. Like, I mean, if 10 days of build, this should have been the first night, you know, that they should have played this and been playing off of this for the last 10 days.
It got over Undertaker, it got over this particular match, and it got over the Hell in a Cell concept all in this promo. Like you said, dude, it's just a tremendous piece of business. And one of Undertaker's best promos I think we've seen over the past 68 episodes, man. Hands down.
A tableau, if you will. That's another callback.
Also, does it possibly mean that the Undertaker is some sort of werewolf type creature now, because he talks about having an inner animal inside of him that comes out.
It's an altered beast.
Maybe something like that.
He might be.
Unfortunately,
well, let's remember that he wants to grind someone's face into the mesh, because I want to bring that up when we get into the actual, because someone else was watching this promo. I would say.
Let's put that on the back burner here.
Yep.
Because unfortunately, this show gets derailed as Vince McMahon and the Stooges come out to kill the show. That was one of the best promos you've ever heard. And this next one's one of the worst. This is five minutes of rambling, time killing. This promo sucks.
Well, I have my... I brought this up earlier. I have my idea as to why they did this. I mean, to set up for what happens during the actual match at the end. But also, I really think that because you have all these top guys in this one match, it really, like, killed the rest of the card. Like, you know, they had to stall for time, kind of. And so I really think, because this, what Vince and the Stooges do here could have been done in a 90-second backstage promo, you know?
Yes.
There's no reason for them to waste the time to play No Chance in Hell, come out to the ring, talk about all this stuff, because all they really do is talk about Vince, like, he wants to get the fans to come forward and show support to get the six-man Hell in a Cell canceled because how dangerous this match is. Like, what? That's so stupid. Like, I don't know, but it plays into what happens during the match, but it's still, like I said, man, it just, I really think it's a waste of time, because they had to scramble to find something to do because all their main guys were in one match together.
That's a good point that I didn't really think about. But I what really bugs me about it is that it's building up this feud between Vince McMahon and Mick Foley, between like two general manager figures. And God, I hate that we've been seeing it for so many years now. Maybe that's why it just rubs me the wrong way here 20 years later. But God, it's so, Vince McMahon and Mick Foley are never going to have a match with each other. Like, why are we building up this feud between them? It's just, I hate it. It takes away the focus from this brutal match that we're about to see. Yeah. And like the video package before the match, it's also, it's more about Vince McMahon and Mick Foley than it is about six Hall of Famers that we're going to get to see. So just, it bugs me, and stuff during the match too. So anyway,
It's crazy, man. But we're almost to the match now, because there's a couple more things happening on this pay-per-view. Like I said, I think they're just killing time, dude, because we get Shawn Michaels live from WWF New York, and he's talking about the cell, Taker's a different man, and the other participants better watch out. So I thought that was pretty cool that he specifically puts over Taker, you know, because he's been in the match with him. Yeah. And again, that's what we're doing here, is talking Taker. So, and then we see Triple H telling Stephanie that the title is the most important thing to him in his life, which, that kind of sucks for her as his wife then. But he's like, I don't care if it takes my last breath, no one's going to stop me from becoming champion. So let me see, JR interviewing Austin earlier today, and dude, Austin has a full beard here.
Interesting.
But then during the match, he doesn't. So I guess he shaved at some point during the day. But he's got, like, I do not remember his beard, but he has an actual full beard here. So I don't know, but he talks about how he hadn't slept because he's been thinking about the match, and having Triple H and the Big Brown Machine in the match are definitely distraction, but they're also motivation from the win to kind of stick it to them for what they did to him, put him on the shelf for 13 months. So then the Rock is interviewed by Harmony backstage and doesn't really say much, does a few catchphrases out and says, "I'm going to win tonight." So that brings us to the video package and the actual match itself. So
main event, Undertaker versus Rock versus Stone Cold Steve Austin versus Triple H versus Rikishi versus Kurt Angle for the WWF Championship, Hell in a Cell, or Hell in the Cell, as the title card calls it. They can't figure out what it's supposed to be.
They don't know what it is. Yeah.
Triple H is out first, then Rikishi, and then, oddly enough, Kurt Angle, the champ, is out third.
He came and get his own, like, I don't know.
Yeah.
His intro, but again, you get the three biggest names in the company coming out right after him, so I guess I understand. So.
And as we mentioned earlier, as you heard at the beginning of the show, we've moved on to a new theme for The Undertaker. He debuts the Limp Bizkit Rollin' theme song that he will carry on for quite a bit longer than he did the Kid Rock theme. And God, never been so happy to hear Limp Bizkit before in my life.
Yeah, never.
Maybe people don't remember, but God, dude, Limp Bizkit was huge. In the year 2001, 2002, they were one of the biggest bands in the world, and this was a big deal. This was cool. Like, for the time, that was a cool thing for him to have, and it's like, we can definitely make fun of it now and hate on it now, but that was a pretty big deal, and it was also very special. No one had current music or music outside of Jim Johnston stuff back then. Like, no one had anything like
that. Taker's the only one that got that.
It really set him apart and made him special.
Well, now Austin tried it. I mean, when he came back to Denver, he had Disturbed, but his version was like, it was basically his song. They just did, you know, a version of his song. But yeah, you're right. I mean, they're licensing American BA and Roland just for Undertaker's use, you know, so it's pretty cool. No one else gets that, like you said. So I didn't think about that, man. Taker's the freaking man.
And it's something we've only seen a few times afterward, like with CM Punk and now Ronda Rousey. Like, it's still very rare that we ever see anything like that.
Yeah, very true.
JR gets... I know I said King had the line of the night earlier. Maybe it's JR as Undertaker's coming out. And JR assures us that... I don't know how JR knows that, but I'm just going to let that be.
Well, he can assure us that, so yeah, I don't want to know.
Sassafras.
Oh, man. Exactly.
Lamb biscuits.
Oh, man. Well,
please.
I don't know how to recover from that. So when Angle came out, he stayed outside the cell. So then Rock comes out next, and he's like unfazed. He just paces right into the ring, goes in there. Austin comes out, as I mentioned, with his new crappy music. Ugh. And he gets in the ring. And there's about, what, half a dozen referees in the ring trying to keep them separated before they actually get to it. So Austin goes in. Of course, when he gets in the ring, all hell breaks loose, basically. He goes straight for Angle outside the cell and then throws him to the door, and then the match can basically begin. We got Austin and Triple H paired off. Rikishi and Rock paired off, and Taker and Angle. Lots of punches, lots of heads to the cell.
Mm-hmm.
I know it's not a lot of forearms like a battle royal, but it's lots of punches, lots of just little things. There's not going to be a lot of quote-unquote wrestling in this match to cover, but there is a lot to cover. So we're going to try to get through it here.
Yeah, I don't know how we can do it. We'll just try to tackle it the best we can, but try to tell the story of it, maybe more so than doing play-by-play for everything, hit the high spots. But, you know, it's definitely, maybe it's bad to compare things to each other, but I guess that's what we're doing here. But just going back to that Final Four match with Taker, Vader, Hitman, and Austin, and just remembering... how it was just constant action with everybody the whole time. Mm-hmm. And maybe it's because they're confined inside the cell for a big chunk of this, although not for all of it.
Right.
But it just does not have that same urgency and that same pace that match had. There is a lot more. You can already see the evolution of the multi-man matches here in that it's two guys pair off in the ring. Everybody else kind of maybe
sleeps
not,
on the outside.
Yeah, there is a lot more napping in this match than we have seen in some other Fatal 4-Way matches. But also a lot of blood here as it comes fairly early. Like you said, everybody's kind of paired off with each other. Then they kind of switch off, trade dance partners for a little while.
Yeah.
Austin ends up grating Triple H's face on the cage, which cues up the blood tracker for the first juice of the night, and our, I guess, number four for the show altogether.
That's what I wanted to say. I guess Austin was watching that promo from Taker earlier because he grates Triple H's face like cheese grater on the cell. And like you said, Triple H is busted open, and then Austin just grates his face more, and then
he does it all the way around.
He does a marathon lap around the whole cell.
The whole cell.
And just cheese grates his face across the whole thing.
It's so great.
It's gross, but cool visual, you know? So, man, yeah. Good stuff. So
the Three Musketeers fall apart pretty early on here.
Yeah.
Rikishi goes to give Triple H a hug in the ring, but Triple H hits a pedigree on him. Rock breaks up that pin. A lot of two counts, a lot of finishers here. They do early on, that Angled hops in and hits an Olympic slam on Rock.
Yeah.
Then Austin stops that, gets a stunner. Undertaker stops that, gets a choke slam. Triple H stops that one. And so, yeah, just, you know, there is early on, there is a lot of action going on.
Yeah, there is. And this part where you just talked about, well, this is great because Taker pulls Triple H off and takes him to the outside and just ping-pongs his head off of every side of the cell, too. So Triple H is playing like he's the heel that's, you know, kind of getting, I guess, taking all the punishment right now. And, and then Triple H, in a moment that echoes back to his old DX partner, Hunter, he takes him and lawn darts him to the side of the cell just like he did with HBK. So I thought that was pretty cool.
That was
cool callback there. I'm sure that was premeditated.
Well, then here's the part where things really start slowing down. Everybody kind of takes a breath right now because our attention gets pulled to the entryway. Oh my God. This is where it goes off a cliff, man.
The corporate hayride. We didn't get an invitation to the corporate hayride.
I guess because they're in Alabama. Yeah, Vince and the
December,
Stooges drive out
for the hayride
in a giant flatbed truck full of hay for no reason. out of nowhere. It's so bizarre. It's so ridiculous.
How bizarre.
The truck backs up to the cell, and these construction workers hop out and attach a chain to the door to pull the door off the cell as Vince McMahon is screaming at it. And then he wants them to just rip the entire cell down with no concern at all for, you know, the people in the front row who the cell would possibly fall on top of and crush and kill.
Right.
But, you know, whatever. The crowd has no idea what to do with any of this. They're just like not cheering, not booing. It's just so ridiculous.
And not only that, we can't see anything that's happening in the ring this whole time that they're driving out for the hayride and pulling the door off and trying to pull the whole cell down. The camera's focused solely on Vince and his truck and Tony Garea or whoever it is that's pulling stuff down, like, or just this rent-a-cop or whoever it is that's, you know, they got working for him. But it's just, it's entirely, like you mentioned earlier, the whole focus of the story of the match changes and it goes to this Vince McMahon Mick Foley thing. Because then, who saunters out? Mick Foley comes out, punches the Stooges in the face, which is always good to see.
Yeah, yeah.
And then he sets his sights on Vince and basically has Vince escorted out by some rent cops here. That gets a pretty good pop. But again, it's like the story was only built up for like a week, you know, on television. I don't know, it's just definitely takes away from what's supposed to be going on with your six allegedly biggest names in the company in the ring, you know?
It's so contrived, and I just think back to that first Hell in a Cell match and how intricately everything was planned out, and, you know, they had the referee getting hurt, and that's how they got out of the ring, and they, like, built it up, like, the ref, or the cameraman. It was the cameraman.
Cameraman
kept getting in the way and finally got hit. So they like teased it and built it up, and it made sense. It was logical. And now we're just attaching a hay, giant flatbed truck of hay to the door and trying to pull the door off out of nowhere. But that does pave the way for the guys to get outside of the cell here. And they're going to spend a lot of time outside of this Hell in a Cell match. Have we had
a Hell in a Cell where they've stayed in the ring yet?
Not yet, but I guess
it's always been they get. We'll get to that eventually.
Yeah.
Oh my word!
It's so dumb. Triple H stumbles out first and ends up fighting with Stone Cold up near the entryway where they've got all these junkyard cars by the set, and just made me think. They oddly used that as a set quite a lot back in the day, like piles of junkyard cars. I wonder how many times they've done that. But eventually everybody comes outside the cell into the aisleway. Angle, Rock, Rikishi, Undertaker are all out there. And Triple H tosses Austin through one of the car windows for our next blood tracker right up there.
Yep. Yeah, and speaking of cars and car crashes, this match begins to look like a car crash because...
Yes.
Everyone's just like in agony. They're selling. Again, not to mention they're literally up there by a car crash. And then Triple H hits a pedigree on top of the car to Rock, and that apparently makes Rock bleed. So add that to our blood tracker here. So Taker hits a body slam onto the hood of a car onto Kurt Angle, and then he gets shoved head first into the side of a car by Triple H. Taker does. Austin's tossing Hunter in the car. It's just, I mean, a lot more of that by everybody here, basically. And then eventually Taker and Angle make it back to the announce desk, and that's kind of where we're headed at now. Taker's nailing Angle's head in the table, and then somebody grabs a steel chair, and Austin smashes Hunter's head into the hay or cedar chips or whatever it is. It's just this leads to Hunter trying to climb the cell, and this is where we take our next, I guess, act two or act three of this match here. We're going to try to head up into the top of the cell.
Well, on the outside, we also had Angle nail Undertaker with a chair to the face to bust him open as well.
Oh, yeah, right. See, I get lost. So much happening.
Exactly. And I said hay truck. I guess it's not really hay in there. I mean,
it looks like cedar chips once we see the thing. So maybe it's just a giant cage for rabbits that you had.
some sort of farm seed.
I think it's the corporate hayride.
that sounds so much better. But yeah, like you said, everybody's on top of the cell. Angle climbs up the cell to get away from Undertaker. Triple H climbs up to the top of the cell. Austin follows him up. Undertaker climbs up after Angle. JR is screaming about who the Undertaker is going to make famous tonight. And then Taker busts Kurt Angle open. Somehow. Everybody's bleeding except Rikishi, and he's the only one that gets out of bleeding here tonight for reasons we'll find out here in just a second.
Yeah. So, like I said, everybody's bleeding but the Kish, and Taker hammers Angle as Rikishi and Rock are, you know, they're up on top of the cell now, which, again, seeing Rikishi climb that cell is dangerous. So And then Undertaker goes over and he threatens the timekeeper to throw him a chair, or else what JR says. So the timekeeper throws him a chair up there, and he gets it, nails Angle with it, and then Rikishi nails Taker and Angle with the chair, and then in a move that you and I mimicked in our wrestling videos, we would make, Rikishi puts all his weight onto the chair and chokes Taker with it.
So good move. Funny.
Good move, especially when your girth is that big. You can rest all of it onto the edge of a chair and choke someone with it. So, anyway, Angle gets off the top of the cage, and now it's just Rikishi and Taker up there. So, everyone else is scattered.
Well, this is the spot everyone remembers here from this match. Rikishi stumbles over to the edge of the cell, and they tease it here for a few seconds. Undertaker... choke slams, quote unquote, basically kind of shoves Rikishi off the side of the cell into the sawdust on the flatbed truck that just so conveniently happened to be right there. And it's, you know, it's a cool visual, I guess, for what it is, with the sawdust popping up. And as we mentioned before from that Hell in a Cell match with Mankind, it's a good thing. It's a good thing that they made these big crazy spots a lot safer ever since that match. And Every giant spot you've seen since that was a lot more planned out, a lot safer. Yeah. It was crash pads and everything, and that's fine and all. I don't mind that. But just the ridiculousness of of the truck and the sawdust and all that, man. Right. That spot to me has never been one of my favorites, or like it's not as cool as I think they thought it was going to be, or I don't know how other people think of it, but to me it's just kind of it's goofy, it's silly. I don't care for it.
I think the visual of it, I love it. I love the visual of it. I love seeing such a big guy like that. A Rikishi being willing to take that, because remember at Fully Loaded when he jumped off the cage and did this frog splash on the Val Venus, like that's big too, you know. So he's willing to do these death-defying things. So the visual is cool, but like you said, the story, you and I are suckers for story. Like the contrived, just we got to get this hay car out there so he can fall on it. Like
not an announce table, not right. Anything that's already out there by ringside.
Yeah, that's the part that kind of I think you and I both agree. Just kind of it's like what I kind of like a good bump, a good visual is cool, but like the story behind it is what matters too. You know, like what's the point of all of it? Otherwise, we're just, you know, watching, like you said, spot monkeys, you know, yeah. Out there. And speaking of this big bump, this, you know, it's impressive to watch. It has absolutely no room to breathe because what happens next?
Well, you know, just going back to it, I do give Rikishi all the crap. I mean, I respect him for taking the bump. I wasn't saying that, but I remember even back then in 2000 reading about the results online and just like shaking my head like WTF, like
I agree.
Sawdust, I just didn't get it. But it doesn't have much room to breathe, man. Just about 15 seconds after, they show a couple replays, but we're already back down inside the cell as Austin and Rock are having a stare down, and they start going after each other in the ring, completely taking the focus away from everything. And that's going to be it for Undertaker too. That's it for Rikishi, obviously, but Undertaker, he just collapses on top of the cell and takes a nap for the rest of the match, man. I thought that was silly too. Like,
he had trouble getting down. He had trouble getting down from top of the cell a lot of times, apparently.
Yeah.
He has trouble here. I didn't remember him disappearing, but he does. Like you said, but you know, like you said, 15 seconds after Rikishi falls off the top in this impressive bomb, Austin and Rock are nose to nose. The crowd loves it because, again, you got, you know, your two biggest baby faces, you know, slugging away. And again, a future, you know, lead. It's going to be a foreshadowing to what's going to come next year at WrestleMania. So, here's where the end kind of comes pretty quickly here at this point. We got lots of reversals, spine buster by the Rock. Triple H comes in and stops the people's elbow. Rock punches Triple H, and like I said, Taker's sleeping on top. Basically, King's like, Taker hasn't made it down yet. So, again, no reason. He's just out of commission up there. Yeah. So, Rock bottom to Kurt Angle, and Austin stops the count at 2.5. And I just want to point out here, man, Angle's face is bloody mess. I don't know if this is his first time blading or what, but he is bloody.
I think it was. I think it might have been.
Yeah.
Austin hits a stunner on the Rock. Triple H hits that neck breaker like you were talking about on Austin. But Angle rolls over and puts his hand on top of Rock and gets the pin off of Austin's move right there. Gets the three count after 32 minutes and 7 seconds to win the match, somehow escape and retain with his title. But Austin's got to pose here to win. You got to send the fans home happy. Austin pops up and hits one last stunner on Kurt Angle to end the show. Austin must stun.
Exactly. Austin must stun. Hunter must pose. Yeah. Yep.
There you go.
It's cool. We get a cool visual. Everyone's bloody. We get close-ups on everybody, but obviously Rikishi and then Taker's left out of that too. But the other four, we get close-ups on them. You know, just a cool visual of them bleeding, and just to see the war and destruction they've gone through. Again, this match to me, it was 32 minutes, but I don't know why it felt like it didn't feel like that, but because it wasn't like it was super duper exciting and it went by that. It just, I don't know, it didn't feel like 32 minutes, but I don't know. Did it feel that long to you?
No, it had enough action to keep it going, but
right.
This was not one of my favorites, dude. No. I don't know. Yeah. I'd be interested to hear what with our fellow creatures of the night thought of it, but man, maybe it just has a better opinion in my head. This was one of them I was kind of excited to watch, and it did not hold up for me, dude. Not one of my favorites, just a mess. Booking wise, not terrible, but you know, probably the best of the December matches that we've seen so far, but I just really, man, it didn't do anything for me. Watching it back, I have fond memories of, like I said last week, playing the six-man Hell in a Cells on the video game. I love doing that. Those are fun. But this one, just that Vince McMahon's hayride spot just kills it for me, man. I hate that spot, dude. It just doesn't do it for me.
I like the story here of Angle retaining, you know, the fact that he was able to... I mean, I hated it back then. I was like, what the... frick, man, this guy still won. Like, you know, again, like I said, Kurt Angle had me hook, line, and sinker. I was hating him back then, but I like that he was able to overcome this. It's, I mean, it has a quote unquote good spot, you know. I mean, it's a cool visual, but like I said, it's contrived and doesn't mean anything at the end of the day. But continues the rise of Kurt Angle. But like you said, for, it's almost like it was too built up that it couldn't have, you know, like you have these five guys in Rikishi, like. It couldn't have been a barn burner, you know. Like it's almost too much anticipation. It couldn't deliver on the, it couldn't deliver the goods for what it should have. So, yeah. I mean, I don't know. I wouldn't say I really recommend it, but I definitely don't. I mean, you're not going to be disappointed if you watch it, but like, I don't know. It's not. It's not like the other December pay per views, but it's definitely not the best Hell in a Cell either.
It's not a must see, I would say.
No, yeah, there you go.
But I am honestly surprised that they've never done anything quite like it before. I guess the. The Elimination Chamber kind of takes its spot for that six-man match.
And think about it, though. It takes this and makes it better because you have the anticipation for who's going to come out of the pod, and you have the story being told in the match, and you don't just have to see, you know, four guys sleeping around the ring while two guys wrestle, you know. Like, it just I guess the story's better, you know, with the Elimination Chamber. So that's my opinion as to why they, you know, they probably did this as a one-and-done. It was like, well... never really work out.
Well, we want to hear what you think, guys. Hit us up, as always, on our social media, at Talking Taker on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. We love to interact with you. I'm on there. I'm at Alex Dorio as well. And, of course, we got Twitterless Travis. He does check that out and does Facebook stuff on there as well. But you can always interact with us. We love hearing from you. We want to hear what you thought of this match. We appreciate all your comments and feedback. Randy Turco always bringing the good stuff. He's got his Undertaker Christmas ornament up on the tree, much as I do as well. Can't start the season off without the man who walks with angels.
Exactly.
Shout out to the Retro Wrestling Podcast at Retro W Podcast on Twitter. I was asking for comments on this match. They said they agreed with us, man. Hated the hay truck spot with the big quiche. The other participants climbing to the top of the cell and then just climbing down was also kind of lame.
Yeah.
But glad it happened so it would be included on the video games. So in agreement with us on that. Shout out, of course, to the Bottom Line Wrestling Cast. They just did a watch along of the, Cold Day in Hell match from 1997. So if you want a different perspective on that match, you can listen to their podcast as they're going through every Stone Cold Steve Austin matchup as well. Check them out for that. Take and shout out to Saint Ridley Santos on Twitter for giving us our bonus episode idea that we're going to cover here in a few weeks to make up for the Chris Benoit episode, and we will get to that here in the year 2001, as next week we're going to keep rolling on to the last ride and kicking off the year 2001. We're closing out the year 2000. And we're going to cover quite a bit in 2001, another just news-making, history-making, crazy year.
Yeah.
We've got the best WrestleMania of all time coming up, a feud with the two-man power trip. We've got the freaking invasion that we're going to be spending a huge chunk of time on. A lot of tag team action coming up in 2001. The Undertaker's heel turn. His hardcore title win.
And we're gonna... wife?
Oh, God. Why did you bring that up, sir?
It happens.
But before we get to all that, we're going to do something fun next week. as we are going to kick off 2001 with another Royal Rumble watch-along. We did it for the 97 Rumble, and that was the last one that Undertaker has participated in. We're going to do it for 2001, too. We didn't do it for the earlier ones. Maybe we'll get back to those one day for some bonus. Maybe we'll circle back around to the early 90s Rumbles and do some watch-alongs for those to be completists about everything, but... we're going to do this for... We'll cover a little bit of what's going on because we got a few things that happen in between Armageddon and Royal Rumble that we need to talk about. But we'll spend most of the time doing a watch-along for that Royal Rumble match. It's not The Undertaker's most historic Royal Rumble, but we enjoyed doing it last time. We think you guys enjoyed it as well. And it'll be fun for us to just...
Plus, it's a great Rumble, yeah.
It's a great Rumble, and we can kind of riff on some fun stuff in there. So.
Oh, yeah.
Join us next week for that and support the show as always by going to pick up a Talking Taker t-shirt off of TeePublic.com, man. Make great Christmas presents. Any
great
of those
stocking stuffers.
Oh yeah, you get a sticker, a mug, a baby onesie, anything with our logo on there. It'd be great.
And speaking of stocking stuffers and Black Friday gifts and Christmas presents, how about our little poll for Talking Trousers we had.
Oh, yeah, yeah. We had the poll up there to see who wore it best between the Godfather and the Undertaker on those infamous, beautiful snakeskin pants. And, of course, the Undertaker ran away with it 69% to 31%. I mean, Godfather's looking fresh, but you can't beat the original.
He's no Taker. So, but thanks for the pants, buddy. If that's what if they were yours, who knows? The legend will always be alive. We have no idea. I don't ever want to know where those pants came from. Actually, I just want to make up in my head. I don't ever want to know the real story. So.
I agree.
Yeah, I think it's better left unsaid. So, anyway, ladies and gentlemen, we appreciate you being along for the ride. Thanks for putting up with the squeaky noises in the background from my daughter. She's been quiet for most of this last hour or so. But anyway. Thank you guys for being along for the ride with all of us. Hop in sidecar. Like you say, we're going to keep rolling into the year 2001. As I say that, she starts making noises. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, it's late. Take her easy.
And the fact of the matter is that The Rock knows this Sunday night, he has his work cut out for him. The Rock knows he's got 5 other guys he's got to compete with. And even if The Rock has got to beat Kurt Angle, which means... I'm going to drink a big glass of milk, eat some chocolate chip cookies, and then maybe I'll take 3 Viagra. Or maybe The Rock is going to face Rikishi. Beat Rikishi. I did it for The Rock. I did it for the people. I did it. Shut your mouth, you thong-wearing fatty. Or maybe even The Rock has got to beat The Undertaker, the American badass. Beat him so bad that one more time, he'll raise up. Rest in peace. Or maybe The Rock has got to beat Triple H himself, which means he's got to beat the game in the middle of the ring. And he has a $2 slut for a wife!
I can't believe he's saying this. Stephanie is not a... And there's one left.
Well, maybe The Rock has got a beat. Stone Cold Steve Austin, which means I gotta get in my pickup truck, drink some Steve Weisers, listen to some Backstreet Boys.
What? Backstreet Boys?
And that's the bottom line, cause the great one said so.
Backstreet Boys? Oh, Bridge Boys, maybe, but
every man for himself Sunday on pay-per-view.